What you talking about?
This is BBC Radio One Extra Stories.
Discover more.
What they did with jazz samples, what he did with the Jazzmatazz projects, what they did with the Gangsta Foundation, is the epitome of hip-hop.
Good MCs, you gotta have good wordplay, good flows, good delivery, and Guru knew how to deliver, plus his voice, like I've never heard a voice like that.
He didn't even speak like an MC. He spoke like a jazz cat. He was born in the wrong generation.
He left behind the soul of hip-hop, the core of what hip-hop is about, a presence that no one could emulate.
I'm the father of this, hip-hop jazz. When you talk about that, you gotta mention me.
The last voice you heard there was that of Keith Edward Elam, known to the world as Guru. Gifted, unlimited rhymes universal. He's remembered as the father of hip-hop jazz, but also one of the greatest MCs of all time.
All right, what is it you want to do when you grow up?
Hey, yo, I'm going to be a titter.
He made his name as one half of the legendary hip-hop duo Gangstar and went on to reinvent the genre by fusing jazz with hip-hop in his widely acclaimed Jazzmatazz project. But his dazzling music success is just part of his story. A story that ended in tragedy and controversy.
Big L, rest in peace.
Coming up, we'll hear Guru's music and learn about his life with his family, with Gangstar producer DJ Premier, and with Solar, who worked with Guru in the last years of his life and became embroiled in a bitter controversy that had the whole hip-hop community up in arms. This is the story of Guru.
Fresh out the gate again, time to raise the stakes again. Fat my plate again. Y'all cats know we always play to win. GNG to the stars, son. Haters took the too far, son. So that's all for you. I'm wiping out your whole team. Ow, splatter your dreams with lyrics to shatter your schemes. The badder you seem, the more lies you tell. The more lies you sell. Now by surprise you fell into my death trap, right into my clutches. Stupid, you know the guard must bless every single mic he touches. I've suffered just so I could return harder. Wanna be the start a round, make you a martyr. I'll make you famous. Turn around and make you nameless. Cause you never understood how vital to me this rap game is. Save it and hold that, you catch a hot one. Rhymes are chasing fake down soon as I spot one.
If you wanna mess with this, Gangstar, one of the best yet. I'm nice like that.
It's all good in this business of rap.
Full clip. If you wanna mess with this, Gangstar, one of the best yet. I'm nice like that.
Guru was born into a large middle-class family in Boston, Massachusetts in 1961. They lived in Roxbury, a poor neighborhood where African-American families struggled to get by. But his family were different, and they stood out. Guru's brother, Professor Harry Elam Jr.
My mother was the librarian in charge of the schools of Boston, and my father was a first African-American Chief Justice of the Boston Municipal Court and later a Superior Court judge. So we grew up as the judge's kids, and I know that impacted my brother as you had to behave in certain ways because everyone knew who you were.
You wanna mess with them?
We knew about him being the judge's boy. I'd see him at house parties, which was a big thing. I hung with a group of kids who, you know, we were considered hoods, where today they would probably call them thugs, but we were just kids who were street kids.
That was Big Shug, one of the founding members of Gangstar. He and Guru became friends when they were teenagers, despite being from very different backgrounds.
When I came to his house the first time, and a whole bunch of security came, like as soon as I stepped on the lawn, they came out of nowhere, right? And I was like, what's up? And then his father comes out. My nickname was Sugar Bear back then. His father says, they say, oh, you know him? They told me to freeze. And they asked him, he said, oh, he's okay. That Sugar Bear is my son's friend. So I go in. I said, dude, what kind of stuff is this? And then I go in, he has a grand piano in the living room and all this stuff I've never seen like that, you know? So I knew he wasn't like living like I was living, but, you know, that's how different it was.
Take this for example, young brothers want rep, cause in the life they're living, you can't have step. It starts with the young ones doing crimes for fun, and if you ain't down, you'll get played out, son. So let's get a car, you know, a fly with. Get a dent, pull a screwdriver, and be off quick with the dope ride, yeah, and the rowdy crew. We could bag us a Benz and an Audi too. Even a Jeep or van, goddamn, we're getting ours, yo. Take a trip up the strip and be like stars, so it doesn't matter if the cops be scoping. They can't do jack, that's why a young brother's open to do anything, anywhere, any place. Buck wild in another court case. It's
Guru's sister, Patricia Elam.
He wanted to feel authentic. And for him, that meant authentically from the streets. And he wasn't. So that was a disappointment to him. You know, the coolness factor was with the kids who didn't have a two-parent family, didn't have, you know, much money, hustled or whatever. That's what he felt was authentically black. And so that was a real conundrum for him and an identity struggle, I think.
Come With Me gave him that element that he didn't see, that he wished that he could have. Like, as far as the guys I knew, the street respect I got, he was my boy. We used to go to house parties and clubs. We used to be able to get in underage. And the house parties back then, it was always some fights or my crew against someone else. He was a dude who wanted to be, like, tough. You know, I knew he wasn't really tough like that, but he wanted to be something that he really wasn't.
Guru's father, Judge Harry Elam Sr., remembers his son rebelling and their relationship sometimes being tough.
He came to me one day, maybe about 30 to 40. Daddy, why do you have to be a judge? Well, my friends don't like judges. I said, your friends don't like judges? What are you talking about? Well, the judges send youngsters to jail. I had to sit him down because I thought, this kid's on the wrong track.
But Guru was bright and delighted his parents when he moved to Atlanta to study at the prestigious Morehouse College. By total chance, Big Shug was also living in Atlanta, and they hooked up again.
We were hanging every day, going to the malls. And, you know, I could rap. He couldn't rap. I showed him basically how to rap. I worked him every day like how you would train someone to do something. He went back to Boston, and eventually I came back. And when I came back, we connected. And that's when hip-hop started hitting Boston really strong. The kids were popping on the street corners. It was breaking crews. This Boston was like little New York at that point.
Guru, or Keith to some, became more and more into music and eventually decided he wanted to be an MC, which didn't sit well with his father.
All right, what is it you want to do when you grow up?
I thought surely, you know, he would make a good teacher, and I had such a disdain for the gangster rappers, and I couldn't stand their music. And I think that Keith wanted to do this. I was so disappointed.
We wanted to be this group, but we didn't know what to be called, you know? I said, well, you know, since I come from the gang, you know, like, you know, I'm more gangster than you know, and you're like probably the star element and educated. You know, let's just be, no, I want to be gangsters. And then he said, well, what about, like, Star? And I said, well, like, yeah, we could be gang stars. But back then it was Mike, Wanted to Be Down, Mike D, KTE, and Sugar Bear. That was the group Gangstar.
The meaning of the name Gangstar, well, I'll tell you. It means I find my mind can excel to a greater type of thought brought by the things that I've been taught in relation to things that I rebel to. Divinely combined with a sense of confidence, accomplishments are achieved on floppiness, but sloppiness I could never tolerate it.
So the group Gangstar was born. And although they had some success locally, things got tough. Big Shug was tackling drug problems, and there came a point where Guru wanted to move on.
This is the meaning of the name.
Then what happened, we would continue to do shows and stuff, but at that time, the cocaine era had got strong, you know, and I was probably abusing it. I remember one night, he left a note in my mailbox and was like, you know, I can't do this with you, you know, I gotta go to New York, I gotta make it. New York was the Mecca.
Boom, bash, dash, I had to break, I had to get away. Pack my bags to leave for good, it was a Monday. Kissed my mother, gave my pops a pound. Then he hugged me, and then he turned around. I threw the duffel bag over my shoulder. It was time to get props, kid, cause now I'm older. Time to fend for myself, Jack. So I'ma go for mine, and maybe never come back.
Guru's brother Harry again.
I said, you know, how can you do this? You can't just go out there. You gotta have a job. You gotta finish school. But these were things that he believed in, and he made work. But I think it was just his own will to etch out his own path, to be his own man.
BBC Radio One Extra Stories.
Discover more. Brothers are amused by other brothers' reps, but the thing you know best is where the gun is kept. Cause in the night you'll feel fright, and at the sight of a 4/5, I guess you just might wanna do a dance or two. Cause he can maybe bust you for self or with a crew. No matter if you or your brother's a star, he could pop you in jet without a getaway car. And some might say that he's a dummy, but he's sticking you and taking all of your money. It's a daily operation. He might be loose in the park or lurking at the train station. Mad brothers know his name, so he thinks he got a little fame from the stick-up game. And while we're blaming society, he's at a party with his man. They got the eye and the gold chain that the next man's wearing. It looks big, but they ain't staring, just thinking of a way and when to get the brother. They'll be long gone before the kid recovers, and back around the way he'll have the chain on his neck, claiming respect just to get a rap.
Trying to become a rapper in New York wasn't easy back then, especially if you came from Boston.
At that point, it was like if you were a New York rapper, you were the ones getting mic. You know what I mean? And that's what they wanted to hear. Guru even had a tough time when he first came up because he had a strong Boston accent. And they were like, yo, who's this corny sounding dude? And that was New York doing that. So that was the part of hip hop at that time where, you know, names had to mean something. You know what I mean? So he came up with Guru, which was Gifted Unlimited Rhymes Universal.
But things got tougher. Big Shug ended up in prison, and Gangstar's record label wanted to find a new member. However, at the same time, a DJ from Texas called Waxmaster C was also making the move to New York and was told by a friend to send over a demo. He'd later be known as DJ Premier.
I'm Kiki the Guru. Premier is here with the flair. We're running to you, bust your grill with skill. As we build and fulfill, I drop the wisdom. Took wisdom with precision, we drill. We're not the born to be down, cause we're born to be down. We're moving on with the sound. See, we're gonna be around for a long time. I kick the strong rhymes. You're empty-handed and stranded, cause you were standing in the wrong line. This is not the fake, it's for sure pure authentic. The gift is hitting home on your dome, because we meant it. You're needing what we're feeding. Don't heed them, you'll be bleeding. We'll rip you and ship you back, cause you're impeding the progress, and I guess that you should be told now. Lo and behold, how the scroll I'll unfold now. Knowledge, wisdom, peace, I want them true to. In the rarest premiere, and I'm the guru.
Call me guru. Call me guru.
I did a couple of tracks, gave him the guru. Say, I like these tracks you sent me. He said, there's one I'm going to write called Words I Manifest. I thought it sounded hot. We recorded it. And a couple weeks later, once it was done, they were like, yo, Molly Mall's gonna play your record on Friday night. He's gonna start the show with it. And we're like, he's gonna open the show with it.
The first tune I ever heard of Gangstar, I think it was Words I Manifest.
One Extra DJ, Trevor Nelson.
I had it on a 12-inch, and I used to play it at a club called Dance Wicked, a massive rave I used to do under the arches in Vauxhall. And it was a hip-hop dancer's dream tune. It was like jazzy sample. It was amazing. You could tell the producer was on point, and the MC had a flow that was just so hypnotizing. It was very, very bizarre. What a tune. I just remember the sample being brilliant and the delivery. These are the words that I manifest. And I thought, one of my favorite hip-hop groups straight away.
I profess and I don't jest, cause the words I manifest, they will take you, sedate you. And I will stress upon you the need for you all to feed your minds and souls, so you can lead yourself to peace. I got a real objective here. I am effective here, cause I select a clear method for all. Suckers I maul, they fall and crawl into the pit of purgatory. I go for glory, I'm taking inventory, counting all the tough luck ducks while I marry, relate and equate, dictate and debate, cause my fate is to be co-making history. I use sincerity, but I still bury the doubts and questions of all the skeptics. I'm kicking clout and I'll even bet this is true. There's nothing so-so, cause I know right about this minute, I'm in it, admit it, I did it for you. Cause this is what I'm into. So chill while I instill that we almost fulfilled the proper mission for us. And yo, this is a must. Keep these lines up, my rhymes, I attest. I attest. Huh. These are the words that I manifest. I manifest.
These are the words that I manifest.
Chicago-born MC Common.
First time I heard a Gangsta and her Guru's voice was on Manifest. Take heed to the words that are manifest, I manifest. And Guru was speaking, he had a unique voice, unique style. And, you know, he was very, like, it had a pro-black energy to it, the song. And it's just, the beat was dope, and he just had his style down.
Stop. Think for a moment, okay?
The guys I was listening to at the time, Tribe Called Quest, the Jungle Brothers, the champion out of, for me, the killer MC at the time, other than Rakim, was KRS-One.
You must learn. It's calm, yet wild, the style that I speak to deal with facts, and you will never get weak in the heart. In fact, you'll start to illuminate knowledge to others in a song. Let me demonstrate the force of knowledge. Knowledge reigns supreme. The ignorant is ripped to smithereens. What do you mean when you say I'm rebellious? Because I don't accept everything that you're telling us. What are you selling us? The creator dwelling us. I sit in your unknown class while you're failing us. I failed your class because I ain't with your reasoning. You're trying to make me you by seasoning. Up my mind with C. Jane Run. See John walking a hardcore New York. Come on now, that's like a chocolate cow. It doesn't exist, no way, no how. It seems to me that in a school this ebony, African history should be pumped up steadily, but it's not. And this has got to stop. See spot run, run get spot. Insulting to a black mentality, a black way of life or a jet black family. So I include with one concern that you must learn.
KRS-One had an attack about his voice. He had this sort of, he made statements all the time. And, you know, he demanded to be listened to. Guru was more enticing you to listen to him and then hypnotizing you with his sort of monotone. It was just, it was perfect with Premier's production.
DJ Premier, also known as Primo.
The way Guru's voice sounded, I always felt like, man, you need a tracks that make you stand out. So I started using jazz tracks because they were a little more mellow, but I still made the drums hard and I still made them sound like hip-hop beats. But jazz didn't have a lot of singing and it was mainly instrumental. So I was like, man, I could dice this up and make it turn into something else creatively on a hip-hop, you know, format. So that's all I was doing, was to be different because no one was using those sounds.
Discover more. This is BBC. Is BBC Radio 1 Extra Stories.
This is Benji B from BBC Radio 1 and 1 Extra, and you're listening to the story of Guru. People can argue about who's the best producer all day, but one thing no one can argue about is how perfect the marriage of Primo's beats and Guru's voice was. But Guru was a great MC, not just because he was an amazing storyteller, but because of that voice and his delivery. I mean, he even says it himself. Listen to the song, Mostly the Voice. In that chorus is, a lot of rappers got flavor and some got skills, but if your voice ain't dope, then you need to chill. That's what he said in the title. It's true, and it's so true.
My religion is rap, R.A.P. R-E-A-L-I-T-Y-G. Cause when I rock street, kids rejoice. I got mad rhymes, still it's mostly the voice that gets you up, and mostly the voice that makes you buck. A lot of rappers got flavor, and some got skills, but if your voice ain't dope, then you need to
chill. One Extra's DJ Semtex remembers discovering Gangstar's first album.
My first memory of Gangstar is Leather Pants, because there was a track that I heard on the radio in Manchester back in the day called No More Mr. Nice Guy.
No more Mr. Nice Guy. No more Mr. Nice Guy. No more Mr. Nice Guy. No more Mr. Nice Guy.
Swing on the drums, the bounce and the beat and everything. And I immediately went to look for this record. Now, this is before the internet, before you could just download anything. You had to actually go to the record store and seek it out. And all I remember is the cover of Guru wearing leather trousers. And I was like, wow. I thought it was pretty out there.
The music started in the hearts of drums from another land. Played for everyone by sons of the motherland. Sending out a message of peace to everybody. And came across the oceans and change and shame. He's in the pain. And it was without name until some men in New Orleans on Rampart Street put out the sounds, and then they gave it a beat. I'm talking about Jelly Roll, King, and Satch. I'm talking about the music that had no match. Yes, the music. And it was born down there. We're gonna use it. so make the horn sound clear. It's jazz music. Jazz music.
We were still on an independent label when No One Mr. Nice Guy came out. There was a song on there called Jazz Music. Spike Lee was shooting a movie called Mo' Better Blues at the time and called us and asked us, would we be down to do a newer rendition of it?
King Oliver's groove was a train coming through to Chicago, bringing in the New Orleans groove. And with Satchmo Blue, the audience knew Basin Street Blues was the whole house tune. It was music. Great to dance to, great to romance to, with a lot to say to you. Relaying a message, revealing the essence of a jazz thing.
Then things started to really take off, and we put out our first major album, Step in the Arena, in 1990.
Once you step in the arena, cheetah, you're gonna be amazed when you gaze at the armor on this leader, fully clad and glad to fight a cause. I won't pause. Fear is a joke, slow poke. I'm like claws that'll rip, cause your gift is merely flesh, superficial, and I wish you would give it a rest. But if you don't, I'll unsheath my Excalibur like a noble knight. So meet your challenger, a true hero, while you're a true zero. Getting beat to a pulp so that you can't run for help. I heard a gulp in your throat, cause you hope that I'll be merciful. But poop at the maiden strut as I rehearse a few battle drills and watch a bladder spill, yellow fluid. Check how I mellowly do it. Face to feet, do this beat, you can tell I'm into it. As I'm pulling out my lance to kill you and advance through the winner's throne. Cause I own you once you step in the arena.
Benji B.
The combination of those beats and that voice on Step in the Arena, it became the next cassette that would not leave the Walkman. And the next CD that would not leave the CD player. I mean, I could have told you the lyrics back to front, front to back. It was one of those albums back in the days when you used to listen to LPs as LPs, that if I hear the end of one Gangstar song fading out, I already expect what's gonna come next because I'm so used to hearing it in the order of the album. That's how much I loved that.
Common.
I felt Guru embodied like the hip hop culture, but had the intelligence aspect that hip-hop brings, and at the same token it still was street to it. It was just like elevated street, which I think that's what hip-hop is about in many ways.
Their third album, Daily Operation, cemented Gangstar's success and gave worldwide exposure to artists like J. Rue the Damager and Lil Dap. Benji B remembers one of the tracks.
You know, on tracks like Soliloquy of Chaos, when he's telling that story, it's such a simple story, perfectly put. You know, I remember listening to it as a kid and thinking like, okay, you know, five carloads deep, time to go do a show. Got a massive crew and we're ready to roll. And then he's talking about who he's rolling with. I remember he's like, you know, talking about the Gangstar Foundation, got Jerry the Damager with him, you know, Lil Daps with them. They're gonna link Nutcracker in a minute, you know, and then it's like they're outside. Something about, the line is mad long. I'm bobbing my head because the music is on.
The place was packed, the line was long. I was bobbing my head because the music was on. I turned it down, then I peeked to my right. I saw this kid and this girl having a fight. Another kid walked up, mushed the kid in his face, and then the kid pulled out, busting and laid him to waste.
Like, shouts out some other people that he saw there, you know, and then he's painting this picture of like New York night, like the aroma of blunts, the rest of the crew. And you know who's who. This was a night to remember. I had on the beige Tims with the two-tone leather. I remember all this stuff.
Gangstar was gaining fans all over the globe and the respect of artists in the hip-hop world. But Guru's older brother Harry remembers the success wasn't always enough.
To see him there with, between all these buttons and controls, mixing the music, making the music, spending hours getting it right, he found a real joy in terms of that and felt that in terms of what they were doing with the music was significant and meaningful and brought meaning to his life. But sometimes in the world outside of that, there was a struggle for him to find happiness.
Just because I want to, it don't mean I will. And just because I'm angry, it don't mean I'd kill. And just because she looks good, it don't mean I'd hit it. And just because I'm... it don't mean I'm with it. Just because I make records don't mean that I'm gassing. Just because I'm rapping don't mean I chase it. Just because I'm wildin' don't mean I can't stop. I got discipline, baby, and I use it a lot.
musically, we always clicked. We could be mad at each other and literally cut a record an hour later that comes out magnificent and then not speak to each other right afterwards. You know, or he'll just say, yo, I love you, man, because we're happy that the record came out good. You just never knew which way that was going to turn. You know, he was very, 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 very heavy drinker, you know, which caused a lot of problems because he has a temper upon tempers when he drinks.
Guru's sister Patricia would ask him about his drinking.
He'd talk to me about it sometimes, and I'd say, you know, why, you know, can you stop? Can it, does it have to be so much? You know, he had these ideas of how he should be that didn't always gel with how he was. And I think the drinking, he never said this, but I think the drinking somehow eased that or you know, helped that for the moment. Of course, it's not never a long-term solution.
We've had knockdown, dragouts, bruises. These two black marks right there on my hand is from him biting me when I had him in a headlock. And he bit my hand. See that? And they look like teeth marks, right? But I'm so proud to wear those now because those are his teeth marks in my hand. You know, so we've been through it. And through all of that, we'd always give each other hugs, say we love each other, make another record. Do all the fights. He said it on Master Pill. He said, if I have to, I go all out with no mic. Yeah, that's right, because I've survived mad fights. He said, my peeps, I truly care. Because without some of them, I wouldn't be here. And they all know how I feel.
The suckers be like playing themselves to have Master Pill.
Guru's brother, Harry.
As often happens when people work so closely together that there comes a time where you've got to make a either commitment to do it or potentially to pull apart and go in different directions. And the riffs grew.
After on our third album, he started wanting to say, well, I want to do things. And he started Ill Kid Records, which was his alter ego, because whenever he would get drunk and start to wild out, he'd be like, don't make the Ill Kid come out. He drew his own logo, you know, with the bald-headed guy holding a gun in one hand and a record in the other, you know, and I love that logo because it even looks just like him when he turns into the Ill Kid, you know, like you have Dr. Jekyll on the side, you have Guru, and you have the Ill Kid, and then you have Keith.
I'm Mr. Jam, and you're listening to the story of Guru on One Extra.
You are listening to BBC Radio One Extra Stories.
Discover more.
So Guru was about to launch his biggest solo project yet, Jazzmatazz.
Peace, yo, and welcome to Jazzmatazz, an experimental fusion of hip-hop and live jazz. I'm your host, The Guru. That stands for Gifted Unlimited Rhymes Universal. Now, I've always thought of doing something like this, but I didn't want to do it unless it was going to be done right, know what I'm saying? Because hip-hop, rap music, it's real. It's musical, cultural expression based on reality. And at the same time, jazz is real and based on reality. So I want to let you know that it was indeed a blessing and of course a pleasure to work on such a project with so many amazing people. For instance, I got Donald Byrd, Roy Ayers, Lonnie Liston-Smith, Branford Marsalis, Ronnie Jordan, Indira Davenport, Courtney Pine, and MC Solar all in the house. Plus, I got Gary Barnacle, Carlene Anderson, DC Lee, Simon Law, and Zachary Bro doing much work. So without further delay, I say to you, listen and enjoy. And check it out.
Trevor Nelson.
At the time, gangster rap was absolutely massive, and things started getting a little Ghetto Fabulous and all this stuff. He just was in his own zone. He did Jazz Thing, the song, years before for a soundtrack. Loved it. It suited his style totally. Then he did Jazzmatazz Volume 1, which was groundbreaking.
Guru talking on how Jazzmatazz came about.
And everybody was, you know, sampling a lot of jazz, a lot of cats before me, even, you know, Marley, Jazzy Jeff and Fresh Prince, Stetsasonic, so many, you know, G DJ Mark, the 45 King, all those dudes, you know, Tribe, you know. So what I was thinking was, what if we actually get the jazz cats who we sample, get them in the studio, and some vocalists, some top-notch vocalists, whether they be, you know, legends or the up-and-coming ones, and get them together, and what would happen if we put that in the studio, and what would we come up with if we blended that. So it was experimental, and of course, you know, when you're experimenting, you know, some people don't get it, and some do, some embrace it.
To begin with, DJ Semtex definitely had his doubts.
For me, having a single and a track with a rapper, I was just like, what is this pop rubbish? What is this nonsense? And with Jazzmatazz, I was like, yeah, it's good, you know, all right. And, you know, it's jazz and hip-hop, so it was like, you know, he got away with it, and he got away with it on a mainstream level, and he got away with it on a credible level.
I like to push the envelope and see what happens. So what happened was that Jazzmatazz became its own musical genre and influenced other musical genres, I gotta say.
Common was one of the artists Guru invited onto the Jazzmatazz project.
Clarity.
Be yourself, man.
Be so clear. Come
hey,
on.
Yo, just be yourself, man.
And be so clear.
So just be yourself,
y'all,
man.
Be so clear.
Come on, just be yourself, man.
And be so clear, clear.
Just be yourself, man.
Be so clear.
Hey, yo, just be yourself, man.
And be so clear.
So just be yourself,
y'all, be so clear.
Come on, just be yourself, man.
And be so clear, clear.
Bringing artists, whether it's Roy Ayers or, you know, or Donald Byrd, like giving those, like, even though hip-hop artists were sampling them, just to hear them playing on songs and being part of that live, it was just, it was another experience that I think allowed hip-hop to go into other arenas.
Trevor Nelson also got a chance to work on Jazzmatazz.
When I joined Cool Tempo Records, I remember they were one of the reasons I joined the label, because Jazzmatazz 1 had already been released, and I got a chance to A&R Jazzmatazz 2 from the UK. So, you know, organising him, hooking up with Jamiroquai and Chaka Khan and people like that, was a thrill to work on that project.
He wants you to reach in and pull out that greatness, pull out that, like, the best in you when he's working. But he was easy to work with, very free, wanting to just keep good elements around and try different ideas.
It definitely was something that was positive for hip-hop. I think it was something that was positive for Guru, but ultimately I think it was positive for Gangstar as well, because I think while Primo was doing beats for, like, different artists and some of the hottest artists that's still relevant to this day, he also laid the groundwork and the foundation for something totally different.
For Guru, Jazzmatazz offered him a chance to be truly experimental. But when he returned to working as part of Gangstar, it didn't seem to be as comfortable as it once had been. On Gangstar's most successful album, Moment of Truth, Guru talked about maintaining his relationship with DJ Premier.
It's like a friendship and a business partnership. And we have to always be conscious of the difference between them, because, you know, some things can happen that are ruin one or the other. So we always stay conscious of those things, those obstacles that can, you know, trip us up, because we ain't trying to go out like that.
Friends, business, friends, business, friends, business.
But while working on the next Gangstar release, things were slowly starting to change behind the scenes. Gangstar producer DJ Premier.
When we did The Owners, we had a whole new staff than what we had when we did Moment of Truth and Full Clip. The president that we had was way, way distant from understanding hip-hop. He was trying to tell us what singles to pick, and then he was harder to reach. He wouldn't pick up the phone for us on the regular.
In the end, Guru was so unhappy with the label staff, he refused to do any more work on the album.
So he was like, until they're gone, I'm not recording with them, I'm gonna start working on my next Jazzmatazz album, which he did. And I actually did the second single for that. Again, we're still working together, just not on Gangstar.
Scales.
It was around this time Guru got introduced to and became really good friends with a producer called Solar.
I actually went on some of the tours with Gangstar, was in the Skills video, and I spent a lot of time around the whole Gangstar Foundation, and I was, I wouldn't go so far as to say friends with all of them, but I was definitely friends with a few of them, you know. We shared moments, we shared experiences, and, you know, that was it.
We did one show in Colorado, and it was the first and only time that Solar traveled with us. He'd been on other shows. That's the only time he ever traveled with our entourage, because we always travel with the same heads. And I remember that show, and, you know, we had a good time. We partied with a whole bunch of girls, and everything was good. The day we get back, he just said, you know, I'm going to take a break, and I'm going to start working with Solar. And I was like, okay. We didn't think nothing of it. And I mean, it was like, all right, cool. And then no biggie, they were already working together.
Solar and Guru set up their own label called 7 Grand Records and launched their first album, Version 7.0, The Street Scriptures.
He was talking all wild and he knew that he was frontin', and he slept on his job so he didn't see us coming. Had to fall back, he didn't want no problems. It wouldn't be a nice thing to get involved. It's them loudmouth cats that get you into trouble. Keep your nose clean, that way you can slowly bubble. I created the man and created supply. If I had a school, rappers couldn't wait to apply. I'm tremendously tight when defending my right. I throw a combo and then I'm ending a fight. The GYU was Solar on the track.
We launched the album. Ultimately, it ended up being the top independent hip-hop record of 2005, 2006. And, you know, we put a tour together to go with it. And and we started gigging. And, you know, the fans was crazy. So the show evolved into what I believe to be one of the best touring acts of the decade.
Whilst Guru was working on the new tour with Solar, Premier found it harder and harder to get in touch.
We tried to reach out to him, he won't answer the phone, he won't call us back. And that just really bothered me, because I was like, this isn't like him. You know, we didn't have any drama, everything was cool, so I didn't understand why the communication just started to just completely cut off. So I just kept on going into producing and whatnot, and just, you know, dealing with the questions. When people kept saying, is there going to be another Gangsta album? Is there going to be another one? And I kept saying, hey, whenever he's ready, I'm ready. And it just never happened.
DJ Semtex saw how deep that divide had become when he interviewed Guru and Solar for BBC Radio 1 Extra in 2007. They were in London to promote the new Jazzmatazz volume.
Well, look, let's get into a joint from that album. It's Jazzmatazz 4. Which joint do you want to go for?
We're going to go for this one. We'll set it off. Lovely. Big up to my man Damian Marley, man. This is a track for all my rude boys out there and rude girls, you know what I'm saying? It's got flavor, man, for the breakers and all that. Yeah, man. Guru, Super Producer Solar, 7 Grand, 1 Extra, Semtex. Oh boy, the mixtape Friday night. This one is called Stand Up, Some Things Will Never Change.
Man, a lyrical vanguard. Well, are we set the standard?
After talking about one of the new tracks on the album, Semtex asked the one question everyone wanted the answer to.
Everything was cool and the interview was really happy to see me and everything. So then I got to it and I said, look, you know, when are you going to do a track again with Primo? Now, he turned his back on me in the middle of the interview and he said, you know, I'm not here to talk about that. I'm here to talk about Jazzmatazz and da-da-da-da.
To be honest with you, I want to be fair to those Jazzmatazz fans, because there are some Gangsta fans, of course, who love Jazzmatazz as well. But then there's some Jazzmatazz fans who really just got introduced to hip-hop through Jazzmatazz. Mm-hmm. So I want to be fair with them, but you can holler at me and we could discuss that maybe some other time or something like that. But yeah, it's all about 7 Grand, yeah, Jazzmatazz, you know what I mean? And it's all about, you know, pushing the envelope. Jazzmatazz is hip-hop plus, man.
There it is.
I gotta say, are you and Primo still cool?
Yeah, well, I haven't talked to him in a while. So.
Right. To turn your back on someone when they're talking to you is the most offensive thing you can do, and it is a real sign that that person doesn't want to speak to you. And he's a nice guy, he was cool with me, and I know he wouldn't mean anything disrespectful, but I think that issue was such a difficult point for him. Yeah, he just switched off. From that, it was very definitive. It was very, for me, it was a bit shocking, because when it felt like, all right, this has gone too far for them to heal their wounds.
The hip-hop world was left to speculate as to why Guru and Primo had drifted so far apart, and rumours started circulating. DJ Premier.
Every promoter in Europe would book me, and they would be like, hey man, we had Guru and Solar here the other day. And they were like, oh, it was a nightmare. And I'm like, what happened? And they would tell us the same story of how Guru was being, you know, told what to do. And I'm like, what? That's not my man. That's not the dude that I love and lived with, fought with, shared women with. That's not my dude. So that's why I was just like, what's going on? Like, we're in the dark too.
Solar.
This is nonsense, anybody saying that Guru wasn't his own man. Guru made every decision for his life according to how Guru wanted to live his life. There was no Solar telling him, do this or do that. That's nonsense. Solar didn't stop Guru from doing anything. Guru was happy doing Jazzmatazz. He felt that Jazzmatazz was a better fit. He liked touring with me. He enjoyed touring with me. He enjoyed running the record company with me. I don't think that anybody should have tried to stop him from doing that. I think that, in hindsight, they're completely wrong. Guru did not want to go back to Gangstar. It's that simple.
First of all, we never broke up. We are still signed to a contract. Number two, Guru never said it's over. It was never that. You never heard that. What can I do if he's not communicating with me? You just gotta let him be him. He's a man.
Guru's sister, Patricia.
I did not talk to him as much as I would have liked or usually did. We didn't fall out at all. You know, I would just ask him questions like, why this dude? Why are you letting him have so much power in your life? Why? I just didn't get it. I just saw nothing positive about him. So, I was sad about that. I was sad that my brother did and didn't see through him.
Were about to take an even more dramatic turn. Whilst working on the next album with Solar, Guru began to feel unwell.
We're going into promo for 8.0. He detects a problem, that he detects that he's ill, that he's starting to have some back pain is how it started. And he went to see a doctor.
Sadly, the doctors told Guru he was suffering from cancer, and he began to undergo a range of treatment to get better.
We didn't know anything about. We didn't know he was ill at all. Later, we found out he had been ill since the summer. No one knew that. Okay, if we had, it would never have been the way it was.
Guru made the decision to have an operation to remove the cancer. And I don't care what type of operation it is. You got to go under, and it's for a while. Somebody has to be put in charge of the business. Somebody has to be put in charge of actually looking after you if things don't go right in operation. The decision was made to place me as his health proxy and power of attorney. And we sat down and we had a very long talk, you know, with tears in my eyes. Yeah. About him not being around anymore. And I'm like, you know, listen, man, you're not going nowhere, and I know you're not going nowhere, and we're gonna beat this thing, you know.
Guru's brother, Harry.
My sister never trusted Solar. And I wanted to trust Solar because he was someone who was so important to my brother. And so I made the tragic error of feeling that, you know, this was my brother's partner, whatever. I feel okay with not signing this health proxy at the hospital, you know, because I'm not going to be here. I got to go back to California. And letting Solar be there, and that was a mistake. I was told by doctors that the health proxy said that no one other than he and his wife were allowed to see my brother.
Guru's sister Patricia did see her brother before he died, but she says she was delayed because she was discouraged from visiting.
It was disturbing because we had actually made plans to go, and then Solar called my brother back and said, oh, you don't need to come now, he's okay. And I still wanted to go, but, you know, my other brother convinced me to wait, and we waited, and then it was too late.
When I told him that his sister was coming to the hospital, he said he got upset. He got very upset, and I told his father. I said, Guru's adamant. He doesn't want it there. What can I do? He gave instructions like any star, any person does. I mean, you or me, if we go in the hospital, you're gonna say, okay, this person, this person, this person, and that's it.
Guru's nephew Justin became very frustrated with the situation, and he took matters into his own hands.
I was just getting, you know, stressed out of that, not really getting the correct information, or feeling like I needed more information because I couldn't talk to the doctors, and my only source was Solar. And so I was like, you know, what is going on? So I kind of made a YouTube video.
Solar has completely cut us off. My family has no way of knowing what is going on with Guru's situation. Solar has complete control over the flow of information given from the hospital and will not disclose any information with us. The doctors and the staff at the hospital will not discuss any information with Guru's family. So essentially, if my grandfather, Guru's father, decided that he wanted to head up to New York and see his son, they would not let him because he is not Solar.
Keep your feet out my shoes.
When I went to go see him, it took me 4 hours to do so. It took Solar to come down to the hospital. I wasn't even able to see my uncle without Solar being in the room. I wasn't able to spend my last moments with him without having him right behind me, sitting there watching me. Just shows the control that this guy had over the whole situation.
Justin described his trip to New York in a second video on YouTube. But Solar says both videos were filled with lies.
First lie was that they were prevented, that Justin put the video out on the internet that said that I prevented his family from seeing Guru. Then you get video two. Oh, well, I went, but then there was a problem. I would say all credibility should be gone there. If the media has any sense of responsibility, at that point they should have reported that these people are lying. And it's sad, but they're lying. You're caught in a lie. You're talking about things I've said that you don't like. That's fine, but it's not lying. You haven't talked to Guru in 10 years. You've had no contact with Guru. You don't have nothing, not a picture with him, his son, not a memory, not a photo, nothing. Not his father, Trish and Premier. They just were not involved in Guru's life.
I had talked to my brother, I'd say maybe 2 weeks before I got the call that, you know, he was very ill. And of course he hadn't mentioned that he was ill. Yeah. I mean, once Solar came into the picture, our relationship changed only because Solar had some ability to separate Keith from everyone who cared about him.
Guru's father, Harry Elam Sr.
Just before he went into a coma, Solar called me and said, yeah, I have a young man who wants to talk to you. And Keith's voice came on, and he was sort of gasping for breath. Hi, Daddy. It's hard for me to breathe. I love you or something. Those were his last words. And right after that, he went into a coma. And both my daughter and my son had gone, were on their way to the hospital. And by the time they got there, he was into this coma.
They called it an anoxic state. It wasn't a coma per se. He would come in and out. He ultimately fell into you know, a very, very deep state, which coma was involved, but it wasn't at that point.
There was rumors and tweets, hey, I'm awake, I'm a little weak, but I'm okay. There was none of that. He never regained consciousness. And then it's like, why lie when he never regained consciousness? And the neurologists were fans. You know, I could say it now because, you know, he's gone, but they wanted him to pull through, but they were like, he needs to hear more than just silence. He needs to hear music and voices of people that love him.
You had people coming to the hospital pretending to be his family, trying to get up. They had to have Rockland County Police at one point guarding because people had snuck up there. I think it was, I don't know who, I don't even want to say any names. Somebody had gotten into the hospital to see Guru wasn't allowed.
Tell the people what you're here for.
DJ Premier again.
I found a way to get in, and I'm glad I got to see him, even though he was under the circumstance that he was under, because I got to still talk to him. I brought a Gangstar t-shirt with me. I saw him, I took the shirt, and I rubbed it on his body and just let him, you know, it's like, hey, man, the logo's yours, you know, feel this, you know, one more time, because I could just tell he was already too gone. Just with the respirator and his eyes were flickering like if he was trying to wake up. And it was just a really, really sad sight. And it's the memory I'm going to always have because, that's what I saw before he left us.
Keith Guru Elam passed away on April 19th, 2010. He was just 48 years old. The shock was felt not just amongst his family and friends, but also in the hip-hop community across the world. Trevor Nelson.
He was genuinely an artist who, whenever he came to London, he tried to find me. You know, he was a nice guy. He's a genuinely nice guy. So I was really sad. And you know, the most disappointing thing about Guru's passing is that him and Premier just didn't seem to be, hadn't settled everything. You know what I mean? They didn't seem to be, they were so tight originally. I was gutted for him because I hate the rumours going around about him. I hate the speculations. And Guru's story just didn't sound great. It sounded like such a sad end.
Actions have reactions. Don't be quick to judge. You may not know the hardships people don't speak of. It's best to step back and observe with coup, for we all must meet our moment of truth.
And the rumours and speculation didn't stop. Solar released a statement on the day that Guru died that contained a message Solar claimed was from Guru to his fans. The statement, which has been verified by Solar, read, "I, Guru, am writing this letter to my fans, friends, and loved ones around the world. I have had a long battle with cancer and have succumbed to the disease. I have suffered with this illness for over a year. I have exhausted all medical options." The statement then goes on, "Any awards or tributes should be accepted, organised, and approved by Solar on behalf of myself and my son until he is of age to accept on his own. I do not wish my ex-DJ to have anything to do with my name, likeness, events, tributes, etc., connected in any way to my situation, including any use of my name or circumstance for any reason, and I have instructed my lawyers to enforce this. I had nothing to do with him in life for over 7 years and want nothing to do with him in death." The statement ends by saying, "The work I have done with Solar represents a legacy far beyond its time, and it is my most creative and experimental to date. I hope that our music will receive the attention it deserves, as it is some of the best work I have done and represents some of the best years of my life." Here's Solar about that statement.
He knew that Premier was certain things was going on. He knew that these people were not going to be friendly to the idea that Solar was going to take over and run the business. He knew that. He wasn't foolish. And he knew that with him out of the picture or down, that they were going to swoop in and take advantage. And he was 100% right.
There was a big reaction from the hip-hop community disputing the letter and calling Solar a liar. Twitter lit up with accusations. Rapper Bumpy Knuckles tweeted, "Guru and DJ Premier made real hip-hop together. No one will be able to cloud that with fake letters and phony statements." The Roots Questlove tweeted, "Not trying to bring negativity into the situation, but I do not believe he wrote that letter. One, he was in a coma. Two, he was in a coma." DJ Premier also had his doubts.
When I saw the letter and read it, it's like, why would you be getting ready to die and want to talk about not allowing me? You know, like, I'm not going to sit there and be like, I don't want to talk to him, and I don't want him to. Yeah, I mean, and the craziest thing was, I don't want my, for one, ex DJ. I felt like I was an ex boyfriend or something. You know,
it didn't sound like anything he would say. He was certainly just someone's dying. That's what they're gonna talk about. I don't think so. So just knowing my brother was just absurd. Didn't even no.
Trish hadn't been around him for 10 years, so she doesn't know how he phrases his words. Premier hasn't talked to Guru in 10 years, so who is saying that it's not his words? Who's in a better authority to say that? Me and everybody in Rockland County that knows him, who's seen him every day and talked to him, his doctors, nurses, everybody who were there, or people who haven't seen him in 10 years? Who's more accurate or more authorized? Who has the legal right to speak for Guru? He didn't give them a legal right to speak for him. I have the legal authoritative right to speak for Guru. And that is how Guru felt. And in fact, it was edited down. I calmed it down as much as possible. But Guru wanted his fans to know, and the people that were doing this, to know
that this wasn't going to be done in secret, that you weren't going to be able to do all of this behavior and just get away with it.
We asked Solar if he felt he could have made it clear the statement wasn't actually written by Guru himself.
I never said that he wrote that letter. Guru had made his feelings felt, how he felt and what he wanted his fans to know. And I comprised his feelings into the press release. Anybody who knows the press release is not written by the person who releases it. The press release was given to the press release person. They drafted it. To be honest, I looked at it and I examined it, but not from the point of view that this is going to be accepted as and picked apart, be made a lie. If you want it to be a lie, then I guess it, make it a lie. All right, what in it is a lie? Then I would say to them, what is it is not true in it?
Whatever the rights and wrongs of what happened back then, nothing will bring back Guru.
There's not a day that goes by that we don't think about him or talk about him, play his music, make sure, you know, that we embrace his son and let his son know what a wonderful dad he had, and, you know, day by day.
For Solar, part of honoring Guru's legacy is achieved through music, and he's recently announced he's relaunching Jazzmatazz.
This is, of course, a continuation. The touring, we're coming into the 20th anniversary of Jazzmatazz, so, of course, I have, you know, plans to make sure that Jazzmatazz is commemorated in an edition for Guru, and to continue the vision that Guru had, and to continue success for myself that Guru would have wanted me to have, like any brother would want to see his brother succeed.
Guru's vision is, of course, felt all around us and can be heard in many of today's biggest artists. Here's Semtex.
Jay Electronic was definitely influenced by a gangster. You know, I caught up with him recently in the process of making his album, and he played me a track before he leaked it online, and it was a dedication to Guru. And the track, it was actually called Jazzmatazz, and he raps on the record and he sounds like Guru. It's really, really eerie. When I was in the studio in Camden, I actually thought, I was just like, is this an old vocal or something?
Boom, bash, dash, I had to break, I had to get away. Pack my bags, headed for Greyhound, it was a Monday. Time to start my mission. I felt that burning feeling in my soul, I had to listen. I had this reoccurring dream from the stage in a suit with a fade. I had set the game ablaze and they threw me a parade. I stacked a little change and took my family out the caves. But I was trapped in the maze like a lab rat, and at the bottom of the barrel where they keep the crabs at. No Geico, no Aflac, nothing to fall back on. But the streets were cussed out the police and so they crack on. Better known as back home, where they treat the Arabs and the Spanish and the blacks wrong. There he go with that song.
I think the spirit of Gangsta will live on for many, many, many years to come. Many artists to come, they're going to take inspiration from what they achieved and what they did, whether it's the art of using jazz music, whether it's the art of the collaboration, or whether it's the art of the two-man team. One man makes the beats, one man raps. When you look at groups like 1982, which is made up of Static Selector and Terminology, they openly say, this, we're doing what they did. You know, we were inspired by their legacy.
And for Premier, Guru lives on through his son.
He has a beautiful son who's 12 years old, who I still communicate with. I'm teaching him how to DJ. I took him to meet Jay-Z. I took him backstage, and it was beautiful to see Jay-Z saying, hey, man, your father's one of the most incredible rappers ever.
The real hip-hop, MCing, and DJing from your own mind, you know?
And that, of course, despite all the drama and scandal at the end of his life, is what we remember about Guru. The genius Boston MC with the monotone voice. The thoughtful storyteller who wasn't afraid to speak the truth. The vision to bring jazz and hip-hop together in a way we've not heard before. He is one of the greatest of all time.
Who's this suspicious character strapped with the sounds profound? Similar to rounds spit by derringers. You're in the terror dome like my man Chuck D said. It's time to dethrone you clones and all you knuckleheads. Cause MCs have used up extended warranties, while real MCs and DJs are a minority. But right about
now I use my authority, cause I'm like the wizard and you look lost like Dorothy. The horror be when I return for my real people. Words of split wigs hitting like some double desert eagles. Sporting caps pulled low and baggy slacks. Subtracting all the rappers who lack over premieres tracks. Severe facts have brought this rap game to near collapse. So as I have in the past, I will dropping lyrics that be harder than sex and candle wax. And one dimensional MCs can't handle that. While the world's revolving on its axis, I come with mad loving plus the illest warlike tactics. The wilderness is filled with this. So many people searching for false bliss. I'm here with the skills you've missed. The rejected stone is now the cornerstone. Sort of like the master builder when I make my way home. You know my Steve.
You know my Steve.
Let them know. Do your thing.
The story of Guru was presented by me, Mr. Jam. It was produced by Susie Warhurst, executive produced by Andrea Rose and Russell Crew, and is a Like It Is production for BBC Radio 1 Extra.
This is BBC Radio 1 Extra Story.